think we both feel that it's okay if our lives are over at any time because we've had so much.
You ready to do a couple twirls?
Ready? That is a quarter ride. We want a big one.
Corkscrews.
I did one last time, didn't I?
You're right.
I spun you around and held you up there for an hour. Anytime.
Okay. Alley-oop. Don't bring the phone.
Oh, boy, here you go again. Bring the phone.
He's got the towel. All right. Okay, back. Oh, excellent. I'm impressed, Air.
Charlie, what about for you personally, though? What does it mean?
This has been Charlie's goal for a long, long time.
On December 13, 1985, camera crews from every network descended on San Jose, California, to capture the excitement of what was to become the most dramatic high school football game ever played, the California Central Coast Championship Game.
This is Levitz to throw. Good pressure by the St. Francis defense. But he gets the ball away to Bush, and Bush is inside the 30 and down to the 29-yard line.
But the media's focus was not so much on the game itself as on what the game meant to one man. Although he couldn't move a muscle or utter a sound, and he depended on a respirator to breathe, Coach Wiedemeyer was calling all the plays, as he had done for the past 9 years. But this night was special. This was to be his final game as head coach. As an athlete, winning was second nature to Charlie Wiedemeyer. An all-around athlete, he was voted Prep Player of the Decade in Hawaii and played quarterback and flanker on powerhouse Michigan State teams of the late 60s. But in the fall of 1977, Charlie's athletic body began to disintegrate. He had fallen victim to ALS, a terminal illness named after another great athlete, Yankee slugger Lou Gehrig. The doctors told Charlie he had only 1 year to live, but Coach Wiedemeyer had other plans.
And he came to me and asked if he could keep coaching, and I told him yes. And then he said almost half-jokingly, even in a wheelchair. And I said, yeah, as long as you can do the job and want to do the job, you can keep coaching. Well, you've seen him in his cart tonight. You know, there's hardly a man left there except for his mind. The kids have to know that there's a man, you know, that is giving it everything he has.
For more than a decade, Charlie and Lucy Wiedemeyer have faced the ravages of ALS with a courage and determination that has inspired everyone who has come to know them.
Great job, guys.
For the past 7 years, producers Ken Ellis and Deborah G have been filming their story.
1:11 to go, it's 14-12, ball at the 15-yard line. And he's about to kick what would be the winning field goal.
Come on, defense, you can do it.
It's a story about beating the odds, about the power of love and the promise of life.
I don't think Charlie ever thought he'd reach his 40th birthday when he was told at 30 he only had a few years to live. And we've come to the feeling, the belief that it's in God's hands.
He was the smallest kid in all the team pictures, but his Hawaiian elders knew he was special. And when he stepped onto a baseball diamond or a football field or a basketball court, he lived up to the name they had given him, Kale Kaovila, God of Lightning. While his older brother, Squirman Herman Wiedemeyer, earned college All-American honors, Charlie showed even greater promise and was voted Hawaii's Prep Player of the Decade. While teammates and opponents were in awe of his abilities, his most ardent admirer at Punahou High was a blue-eyed beauty named Lucy Dangler. She was the gregarious cheerleader, he was the shy jock. And when Charlie was offered a football scholarship at Michigan State, he made sure Lucy made it to East Lansing too. In college, he played at quarterback, wide receiver, safety, and flanker on the powerhouse Spartan teams coached by Duffy Doherty. And although he was one of the smallest players in the Big Ten, number 11 could do it all.
Everything he did was done with a lot of determination. He was the finest blocker on our team at 5'8", 175 pounds. He would knock those big 6'4", 258-pound ends right flat on their back. He just had that explosiveness, and no one was too big for him to attack.
Charlie's aggressive play earned him a slot on the College All-Star team and the Hula Bowl squad.
He had great intuition as an athlete. He just instinctively did some things that you can't coach.
Charlie and Lucy were married at Michigan State, and soon there were two more Wiedemeyers in the world, a daughter Carrie and a son Collie. In 1972, the family moved to San Jose, California, where Charlie found a job teaching math and coaching football at Los Gatos High School. At 32, Charlie had it all. A comfortable home, a rewarding job, and a loving family, the blueprint for the American dream. And then something went terribly wrong.
You ready for your speed up?
In the fall of 1977, Charlie's doctor told him he had 1 year to live. He had fallen victim to Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS.
No, that's fine. We did too. That's fine.
You're hit with this. You have a terminal illness. You know, it hits you square in the face.
Okay. That's it.
I mean, I could hardly pronounce amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, let alone spell it. And I went immediately to the library, and there was nothing there. In fact, when I looked it up and finally found it in a book, it didn't even say it was terminal.
Well, Charlie, what was your first reaction when the doctor told you that you only had a year to live?
I remember slightly very confused at first with a lot of fear at that time. And, you know, in total disbelief, really.
Amyotrophic lateral sclerosis is a neuromuscular disease that attacks nerve cells, causing muscles to slowly atrophy. There's no known cause or cure for ALS, and it usually claims its victims within 1 to 3 years after it's diagnosed. Charlie had already lived longer than most ALS patients. For him, the illness came on slowly.
Okay, that's good.
He just seemed clumsy at first, stumbling and dropping things. Eventually, his speech became slurred and he lost control of his arms. His mind was not affected, but his finely tuned athletic body was betraying him.
Okay. You want to get in and then sit like you do?
The most frustrating thing is for Charlie to have me do the things that, you know, he's always done. It's easier for us and easier on the children because it's gradual.
How's the shoulder? You have a lot more movement in it.
Do you want me to undo it?
Of course, Charlie refused to let his illness prevent him from doing the things he wanted to do. Like teaching his son the lessons he learned as a black belt karate master.
Yes! I think my father is a great coach. A lot of fathers won't take time out to help their kids to learn and show them how to do things, and our father always does. He teaches you discipline.
Since he had worked hard to earn his college all-star accolades, Charlie demanded 100% from others. And while he was no longer able to show his players how to throw a pass or make a block, he taught them more than any other coach, especially when it came to self-discipline.
Charlie has always demanded that the kids have respect for their coaches. They don't swear. If they do, they have to take a mile.
You're doing really good. How are you doing, Wiedemeyer?
Coach Wiedemeyer can't yell, but Coach Wiedemeyer has something about him where he can just look at you. He doesn't have to act it out.
Talking, I didn't notice that much because I saw him all the time, you know, and, you know, you get used to it. You get used to hearing him.
And then option.
Okay. Pro I-58 option on one, ready?
As Charlie became increasingly disabled, school principal Ted Simonson assigned student aides to help him with chores like writing on the blackboard and climbing stairs.
Occasionally, if the kids just weren't right with him, he could fall. And one day he did fall, and one of the boys came to me and said, "Mr. Simonson, you know, that was just horrible. He fell, it was almost like a ripe melon hitting the pavement.
Unlike many people that have terminal illnesses that really want to lay down and get up, I've been positive. I've always been that way. I've always been a fighter, competitor.
Coach Wiedemeyer's competitive nature was infectious. Man for man, his players were the smallest in the league, but they trained until they were the toughest, practiced until they were the best. And after winning the last game of the season to clinch a league title, the Wildcats gave their coach a moving tribute in the locker room.
He came in and he was kind of glossy-eyed, and he said, he just said in his way, I wish I could hug every single one of you, but I can't. So every player, after everyone finished talking, we all lined up and gave him a hug singly. It was great. It really was.
All right. First of all, I'm saying I'm coming back. All the old men.
The dying will come. We know that. We're just not quite ready for it yet. But I think it's made us realize how precious life is. Nothing. You can't take anything for granted. And, every second makes a big difference, right? And just having a lot of love.
Mm-hmm. That's really how my wife's a very special person, and my two children help a lot. But I think without the encouragement, the support, without their help, I had to come.
Yeah, I'd drive you crazy.
At the end of the 81 school year, Charlie received a letter informing him that his teaching contract would not be renewed.
I don't know if you hear me and understand me, but I want to say one thing. I really appreciate all your help, all your encouragement, all your support.
The letter read, quote, although Charlie can apparently be made more comfortable by physical therapy, there is no way he can be rehabilitated so that he can again teach classes. Should a cure be found or the miracle we all pray for occur, he would be welcomed back to Los Gatos instantly. But Charlie was not about to give up. He would find a way to return for one more season. By the fall of 1982, Charlie could no longer stand or walk. And although he had lost his teaching position, he managed to convince school authorities that he could still do the job of head football coach. Friends donated a golf cart so that he could get around on the field, but getting to and from practice was still a painful ordeal, and the task of communicating with others grew more frustrating every day.
I deal with Mr. Wiedemeyer a lot, and through that, I've learned to understand him more.
Tom, from now on.
Just motion.
Yeah, well.
So I write motion, 23 isolation.
Yeah. That's
sometimes I can't understand him. And since he's so proud, he gets frustrated sometimes, gets mad at me.
Same play from the twin?
Charlie's offensive scheme was as intricate as an NFL playbook, and mastering it required nothing less than total dedication.
No, on the ball.
On the ball!
He doesn't want to go home until that play is right.
No.
And he's got other guys there, other coaches who have been working all day and out there all day, and they're tired and they ache and they want to go home, and no way. We are going to be there until it's done. And whether we go over it 10,000 times.
A lot, man.
He was relentless.
The extra hours of practice mastering Coach Wiedemeyer's sophisticated offense paid off, and the Wildcats were once again league champions in 82 and 83. That year, the entire Los Gatos community seemed to rally behind Charlie. When word of his mounting medical bills leaked out, friends set up a trust fund and held a benefit auction.
So, outrank!
Charlie enjoyed talking with old friends and meeting new admirers at the events, but deep down, he wanted out of the limelight. He didn't want to be patronized and had a hard time accepting charity.
I love you.
They were wonderful people who gave from the heart, but their gifts reminded him of something he was trying to forget.
We could have used you.
He was dying.
Your entire life represents a
victory. My uncle, who's a doctor, I talked to him about a month ago, and he said, do you realize the incredible void that you will have? And I hadn't thought of it in that respect. You know, I just thought, oh, I'll sleep for 3 years. No problem. And no, I don't look at that. I don't want to look at that. I look at day to day. That's hard enough to get through.
For Lucy, there was no such thing as a typical day. But most of them began at 8 a.m. with aerobics class. During the next 24 hours, Lucy would function variously as a cook, a real estate broker, a wife, a mom, and a nurse. High school cheerleader and Mother Teresa rolled into one.
Lucy is always bubbly and outgoing and probably puts on the air that everything is fine. And some people would probably say, well, it's denial.
Oh, this is Ginger that was sent from Hawaii today. So anyway, brought you some non-fattening goodies for the pregame.
Okay. Where's most of the pain? Right inside?
On the top.
Okay. Twice a week, Lucy had to take time out for physical therapy since the strain of lifting Charlie had left her with shoulder and back problems. But she always kept her troubles to herself.
Hello, Mrs. Wiedemeyer.
That's what you need to take a look at. And that's what
to help pay the $1,200 a week nursing bills, Lucy worked part-time as a real estate broker.
I'll have to get you the date. I don't see it right here.
Do you want to see that property?
It's hard because I'll be at the office and all of a sudden, the other day, the nurse called and said the other nurse hadn't come, so I had to rush home.
Will he live through the shave? Uh-oh. You hear that, my wife? Yes, dear? Oh, I don't want to tell the story about the first time I shaved you. You didn't have any sideburns left? I kept trying to even them out. They got shorter and shorter and shorter.
It's horrible for Charlie to be dependent on everybody else. He's always been a perfectionist. He's always been one to take command and do things. I think I felt frustrated that I couldn't do it the way he wanted to. When I first started learning how to brush his teeth, I thought I was going to go crazy. To shave him, we must be, you know, get every little hair on his face. When I used to have to stand him in the shower and try to hold him and, you know, wash his hair and shower him and lean him up and do all those things, I'm just not a strong person, you know. The muscles that he wanted. And so he would, you know, naturally take his frustrations out on me and be angry because things weren't done just the way he wanted to. And it was also, I think, his frustration in losing control.
My circumstances, and maybe this will help other people, my wife has ALS. She is completely incapacitated.
Once a month, Lucy drove up to San Francisco to attend support group meetings with ALS patients and their families. But Charlie stayed at home because he didn't want to see how the other patients were deteriorating.
There's something that hasn't come out of this yet, as much as you said it. Medi-Cal will lie to you. They will just, it's as simple as that. They will just flat lie to you.
Many came to the meeting to vent their anger at a medical system that didn't address their needs. Since Medi-Cal insurance rarely covered the cost of home care, patients had to enter a hospital to receive aid. But most families, like the Wiedemeyers, chose to face the financial and emotional burden of caring for their loved ones at home.
He told me that 80% of the partners or the mates in situations like this desert the sick person. And I think that's an important figure to be aware of, that And people get so defeated, they have to act that way.
It's easy to say, I'm tired, I don't want to deal with it anymore. If I ever think, oh, forget it, I'm going to run away. I don't know, I just couldn't do it without him.
As the 84th season drew to a close, the Wildcats zeroed in on a dream. They were the undefeated league champions again and had advanced for the first time in the school's history to the conference quarterfinal game. His voice was now no more than a whisper, but with his players and coaches reading his lips and Lucy filling in the gaps, Coach Wiedemeyer guided his team to an early lead.
4 or 5, Charlie.
3rd and 5.
What?
Zanardi.
Zanardi, you're tight.
Zanardi, tight end, let's go.
I know when I first got him out in the football field, I mean, I would just see a metamorphosis. I'd sit looking at him on my right side, and he just became a different person. And it's like endorphins are released. I mean, he can cope with everything.
The Wildcats played a nearly flawless game. And when the final gun sounded, they gathered around Charlie's cart to celebrate their triumph.
Just because of the fact that he strives so hard, he's taught me so much about life. I mean, he teaches you not to give up. He teaches you always to keep striving on the football field and off the football field.
You play with a lot of intensity, a lot of enthusiasm. You guys didn't stop for a minute. You play with a lot of mud. And let's keep it going. Yeah.
In the semifinal game the following week, the Wildcats faced their toughest challenge.
Any questions, fellas? Let's get them asked now, because once we hit that field, we'll do nothing but kicking butt.
Their opponents were the defending champions, the St. Francis Lancers. It was a low-scoring battle, fought in the mud. St. Francis scored first, but Los Gatos answered with a touchdown of their own. And when they scored again in the third quarter, they were minutes away from realizing Charlie's dream. Then, in the closing moments of the fourth quarter, St. Francis scored a touchdown to tie the game and send it into overtime. The season turned on a single play. For an instant, there was triumph. The big game was called back on a holding penalty. The dream of victory gave way to the harsh reality of defeat.
It was heartbreaking for the kids. One of our players cried for over an hour, and they just didn't think Charlie would make it either, so that was part of it. You know, they never played a game to win for Charlie, ever, ever. He never asked that of them.
We've never used that as a reason to go out and win. Subconsciously, it's always there that we're winning for him. Knowing Charlie the way I do, I think he was really disappointed for us, that he wanted us to go farther.
He's always said, football is the one classroom where the kids learn to live, learn to deal with victory and defeat in life.
It was heartbreaking for Charlie because he wanted it so badly for his kids, for the team, and he never thought he'd ever be back. And it was just like, okay, guy, if you're not gonna let me win this year, you've got something in store. You're sure that that was a sign? You're certain? You gotta have one more season? At least, right?
Channel 7 News at 6, continues to remind a lot of people just what the spirit behind that sport is all about. And tonight, Channel 7's Tony Russomanno has a report on about how some big names in the National Football League are helping this small-town coach.
He was a Michigan State All-American. A month after suffering through his toughest coaching defeat, Charlie was to receive his finest tribute, and his family flew in from Hawaii to join in the celebration. the NFL Alumni Association had prepared a $100 a plate dinner in his honor to help pay his medical bills.
That love still burns in Charlie Wiedemeyer, unshaken despite the debilitating effects of ALS. Fortunately, Charlie has a lot of friends, the NFL Players Alumni Association among them.
The guest list at the banquet read like an NFL Hall of Fame roll, including Jim Plunkett, R.C. Owens, and Bill Walsh, who took time out from Super Bowl preparations to attend. And Duffy Doherty came all the way from Michigan State.
The ball reads, to Charlie, from one coach to another, with lasting respect, Bill Walsh.
He didn't care about any accolades or anything, anybody honoring him, just to talk to them. It was such a treat to hear from these guys.
For Charlie, the biggest thrill of the evening came when his daughter sang to him.
I think that was the highlight, you know, having her share and sing a song to him. He started to cry. I think the NFL banquet was tough. First of all, because Charlie almost died the week of the banquet. He was just going through such incredible struggles just to breathe, just to keep alive. We all had to assure Charlie that we'd much rather have you like this than not at all.
We're going jogging, guys. Be right back.
One walk. I need a head start.
Maneuvering him, it's amazing because his shoulders are out of their socket. Because he has constant pain, you can only move his head a little bit to the left. It can't go to the right at all. You have to hold his head, hold his shoulders, keep his back up, move his legs.
Oh, your head, a little bit higher.
Oh, it's too high. I'm sorry.
We'll get it.
I think at times when it got so difficult, trying to walk him to the bathroom when he couldn't breathe, all the different things that you don't think about, the daily nitty-gritty things. If he could see me getting tired and I would start to complain or be crabby, he'd feel so badly. And he'd say, I don't want to live.
In August of 1985, Charlie lost 30 pounds. He couldn't eat or sleep and had great difficulty breathing, especially when a series of brush fires swept through the area. But since he had been picked to coach an all-star game, he insisted on attending every practice, and his stubbornness proved nearly fatal.
He just was struggling so severely, and it was just a very, very scary thing, just fighting for every breath. And pretty soon he took a breath that was the last one and he just went totally limp and wasn't breathing at all.
Charlie was rushed to a hospital where doctors performed an emergency tracheotomy, cutting a hole in his windpipe so he could breathe. But since they didn't expect him to survive for more than a few days, they didn't bother to install a voice box, so he could no longer utter a sound. Lying in the intensive care unit, he now weighed less than 100 pounds.
It was very hard. I didn't think I was going to pull through. I've never felt... I've never felt so scared in my life. One doctor later on told us that Charlie wasn't breathing enough to keep a church mouse alive. They have no idea how that man was surviving. He told me, don't put him on life support systems because it'll only prolong the inevitable. We had to literally beg the doctor to put him on a machine. The doctor came into the room and explained all the negatives and said, Charlie, you know you're going to be very sick on this machine. It'll make you susceptible to all kinds of infection. You'll have pneumonia. You'll probably die from it. But, you know, if you're insistent, then I'll go ahead and do it. And Troy said, yes, please. And we were like, give us a machine. Getting air on that machine was the most phenomenal thing.
Over the next few days, Charlie gradually gained strength as he began to focus on football and the All-Star game he was scheduled to coach the following week.
When Charlie wanted to get out of the hospital to go to his football game, the doctor said no. The doctor didn't want him to watch it on television. He said, no, I don't want you to get too emotional.
But Charlie was determined to coach the game, so Lucy cleared a phone line from the hospital to the coach's box at the stadium, and watching a broadcast of the game on a monitor at his bedside, with Lucy relaying his signals, Charlie called the plays from the intensive care unit.
What yard line? What yard line? What?
Can you hear it?
What? I'm sorry. We have our screen first. 90 quick.
Yeah, okay, you got it, right.
Out, Jeff! Out, Jeff!
Back to live action now. Putting it out in front of his receiver, fighting for the football. Touchdown, are they gonna call it a touchdown? And they do. The pass is complete to Deason. Done a good job of putting that offense in, and I know that Charlie and Lucy Wiedemeyer at Santa Teresa Hospital are all excited about this.
Two, do you want two? No.
Charlie's North squad eventually lost the game, but just being involved with it had been a triumph, a feat his doctors couldn't comprehend. And when he wanted to leave the hospital early to visit his family in Hawaii, the doctors said the trip was out of the question.
We had to make a decision within ourselves. Were we gonna stay home, be good boy like the doctor said, and wither away, or were we gonna say, fooey on you and go? It was a real triumph because Charlie had to know he was mobile. I honestly believe if he didn't make that trip, I don't know that he'd get out of the house again.
Charlie went to Honolulu to see his father, who had just been diagnosed as a cancer patient. He also reminisced with his high school football coach at Punahou.
I think Hawaii is much of a spiritual place for Charlie and for myself. There's a certain peace about it. It's a very beautiful place, and it has a lot of memories for us.
Have a nice trip.
Saying goodbye at the airport was the hard part of the trip. His sisters didn't think they would ever see their brother again. But Charlie didn't have time to dwell on his condition. A new football season was just around the corner.
When it starts to tingle?
Tingling. No. Tingled a while ago.
Let me know what's going on.
One game into the 85 season, Kale Wiedemeyer, star running back of the Frosch South team, was nursing a shoulder injury. But like his father, he wasn't about to let a little pain keep him off the field.
I really wish you wouldn't play, but...
Yeah, he said, I can't injure really more. She said I couldn't.
We have all three suction machines in Miami to take. This last
at home, Charlie reviewed his game plan for the evening's confrontation with arch-rival Saratoga High. To avoid communication problems on the field, he had been forced to make a list of every offensive play with an abbreviated code name.
Oh, okay. So that's only if he drops. It has to be okay. Okay. So you want me to put that in there? Okay, let's go.
With a stomach tube providing him a healthy liquid diet, Charlie had managed to gain 40 pounds since his tracheotomy operation. Good news for him and not so good news for friends who volunteered to lift him out of bed.
Pardon me? Tell you when?
You don't have a choice.
Set.
Go.
Go. Oh, he's all you.
When he was off the respirator, the nurses had to use an airbag to keep him breathing. And even when the teamwork was perfect, getting out of the house was still a challenge.
I need the pillow.
You want
the
pillow?
Whoa. Cool. Yeah, you guys There's a lot of phlegm that accumulates in a person's lungs who is on a respirator. And we've been known to sit in the chair ready to leave for a game and have him start coughing and have to suction his trach for an hour before we can even go out the door.
Charlie finally arrived at the field just in time to watch Cully score the winning touchdown in the Frosh South game. But Charlie didn't have time to enjoy his son's heroics. He had his work cut out for him with a varsity squad that had already lost the first game of the season. This team was less talented, less experienced than last year's championship team. And after 9 years of accommodating the head coach's handicap, some of his assistants were feeling the strain.
And you start at the left, and you just, you're like left halfback.
As Charlie has become less able to communicate, it's dramatically upped the workload for the other, rest of the coaching staff. And there has been some dissension, you know. Inevitably, you get strong egos, and all Charlie has left is his ego.
Strong side ends running with our end on the drag. It's coming all the way across.
I was reluctant because of his illness and because of how much we knew football meant to him to say anything. It was just too much of an emotional strain because here you are, you're going up to a very ill person and saying, hey, I don't like this, or I don't agree with this. And you feel, geez, what if, you know, that causes him to get sicker or something. You don't want to really take that burden on.
The Saratoga game would prove to be a crucial test for the team, the staff, and assistant coach Catalico's new communication system. And in the early going, nothing seemed to work.
2C, you're clicking. I can't, you're not receiving.
There is no 2C.
I'm not. What? Pat. Sorry.
You've seen him in his cart tonight. You know, there's hardly a man left there except for his mind. And the kids have to know that there's a man, you know, that is giving it everything he has.
Eventually, the problems on the sidelines were resolved, and on the field, the team began to execute. Although they had been picked to finish only third in their league, they played with a special fire. They trounced Saratoga 20-6 to begin a winning streak that would carry them to the playoffs and another shot at the title.
Come on, you're the singer in the family.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear pops.
To me.
Happy birthday to you.
Well,
you're singing too high for me.
We're lip syncing.
Happy birthday to you.
Okay,
you're
happy birthday.
Us too. Mm-hmm.
Help
you out open.
Here, for you.
Here, dear, here's your card.
Here's your present.
Oh, wait, here's your card.
Come on. Oh, you know, this is last. Okay, are we ready?
I knew it. Da-da-da-da-da-da.
Is that exciting? It's X-rated. Ooh, none of those faces. Okay, which one do you want to see first?
Let's see this one first.
Is anything of me?
Jeez.
Oh my gosh.
Volcano on your head.
Storm.
Ooh, Dad's buffed.
All right. It's windy, Anna. Let me fast forward this.
No.
No?
It was very difficult at first to accept the fact that I couldn't participate with our children and not to be able to hug and kiss them.
Very seldom does Charlie get down. Even when he's down, he's still able to joke. He's still able to make light of a situation. And I think he lots of times does it for Lucy also. I think there's just kind of a give and take there.
What about the physical part, not being able to hug, kiss, or even have sex? I mean, what about the physical part of it?
Well, take your shirt off. Now, behave. This is a family show. Honey, what you don't know.
They still have their tiffs and their disagreements and their lack of communication. I've seen her cry. I've seen her be mad. Just pretty down because she's just so exhausted. And often she'll go sometimes 24 hours without ever having a nurse, that she's taken care of Charlie for 3 shifts straight. I have seen her so tired that she could hardly walk straight, much less talk or think straight. Sometimes you stand by the bed for 2 and 3 hours, just back and forth and back and forth. And, you know, his gag reflex is constantly going, and it's just, it's so hard to watch.
Huvier! This is serious.
I have a chair right next to the foot of the bed, and facing Charlie, facing the head of the bed. I originally would pile up my pillows and I would sleep with my hand on Charlie's foot when he started not being able to speak. But what we found is we have a little beeper system that we put by his foot so he can touch it and an alarm goes off in case I doze off.
Okay, that's working, so I'm gonna go get the washcloth.
I find it very, very difficult watching him sleep. I guess it's because it's the one time he's so helpless. It's hard. I find sometimes I'll just sit and watch, and it's just, it's when he's the, I guess I focus on the fact that he is really, you know, stuck in bed. Well, he can still kiss. He's good at that. He puckers up for you. Not being able to really hug Charlie and have him hug back is so hard. I think it's harder for him than it is for me.
Charlie Wiedemeyer, the Central California Coast Championship game would be the contest of his life. More important than any of the games he played in at Michigan State. His team had come farther than he could ever have imagined, and this was to be his final game as head coach.
This has been Charlie's goal for a long, long time.
Whatever the outcome, this high school football game would be reported on by all 4 networks.
It's the first time in Los Gatos history that Los Gatos High School has been in this far in the playoffs.
The matchup was classic. The underdog Wildcats were to face the undefeated St. Francis Lancers, the team who had defeated Los Gatos in overtime last year.
I can't explain it about being there. It was like, okay, God, this is it. If I die on this field, it's okay. I've made it here. I'm alive to enjoy what I've always wanted to be a part of.
Good luck, Coach. Thank you.
Right, here's the kickoff by Andriotti.
Play ball.
From the opening kickoff, it was clear this game would be a cliffhanger, with 2 determined opponents at the mercy of fate. The teams traded punts in the early going, but late in the first quarter, St. Francis found a seam in the Wildcat defense.
First down by Storm. Danny Wall with the first touchdown of the football game. He goes 22 yards, and St. Francis leads 6-0.
Down by a touchdown, Coach Wiedemeyer marshaled an offensive.
Double pro.
Get in there, Dan. Get in there, Dan.
82 to Jeff.
What?
82 to Jeff. Oh, 86, coach. 86. 86.
To Jeff. For a 6-yard line. Sam Levitt's the quarterback. Borghese, near side.
That's touchdown.
And Borghese scores. We're tied at 6.
Both teams failed to convert the extra point, so the game was tied 6-6, but only for a moment.
Oh! By Bush. Danny Bush down the sideline. Danny Bush all the way down to the 15-yard line of St. Francis, and Los Gatos is in business in this 6-6 tie.
Double pro, 30
Levitt's and company on the 15-yard line of St. Francis.
Well, who's going to get the ball?
Trulak in motion, top of your screen. They go instead Borghese. Borghese will score his second touchdown of this football game.
With a 6-point lead, Coach Wiedemeyer decided to gamble and called for a 2-point conversion try.
And 2:49 left in the second period. They fake the handoff to Borghese, and Levitt's pass in the end zone is a 2-point conversion. And Mike Shalaba made the
reception. For the moment, Charlie's team seemed unstoppable, but they were not to score again. The third quarter wound down in a defensive stalemate. But as the fourth quarter began, the Lancers attacked.
Inbounds, here they come.
Wilt in there. Touchdown.
The St. Francis celebration quickly soured when their 2-point conversion try failed. And with Los Gatos still leading 14-12, the Wildcat defense moved in for the kill.
He's sacked. He fumbles the football.
They recovered the fumble on the 8-yard line, and after 3 running plays, the ball rested on the 2. Fourth down, goal to go. It was the crucial call in the game of his life, and for Charlie, it was a nightmare. He called for a pass, but his coaches didn't understand it.
What do you want to do? Let's go for it. Coach, let's go for it. Sam, what do you want to do? You want to go for it?
Yes.
Get in there.
What happened? I don't understand what's wrong. I was calling, did you want a waggler or a bootleg? Yeah, I called that and he said, no waggler.
And the decision has been made. It will be a field goal try by Dan Bush. Greg Bowman is the holder. The ball placed down at the 8-yard line, an 18-yard try. It's on the way. St. Francis says no good. The officials say no good. Boy, the Lancers dodge a huge bullet here.
Given a second chance with less than 2 minutes to play, the Lancers quarterback launched a Hail Mary bomb. And the prayer was answered. The game would be won or lost on one play. A short field goal try with time running out.
Now the line of scrimmage, Benny, is the 11-yard line. It'd be about a 28-yard try. Is St. Francis about to do it again to Los Gatos for the second consecutive year?
He's taught me so much about life just because of the fact that he strives so hard. I mean, he teaches you not to give up.
We like to win, but we really play football to teach kids something, and I think they learn something from playing with Charlie Wiedemeyer coaching.
He's always said, football is the one classroom where the kids learn to deal with victory and defeat in life.
Come on, defense, you can do it! Come on, defense!
Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's like out of a movie or something.
Yeah, you could see the smile on Charlie Wiedemeyer's face.
Love you.
Yeah, that says it all right there.
played like champions.
Yeah.
Which is all year. You guys have played with a lot of heart.
First of all, we're so proud for each and every one of you. You have accomplished something that no other Las Gatas football team has ever done, and you're going to remember it for the rest of your life.
I think we both deny the fact that he has a terminal illness simply because he's beaten the odds already. And we've come to the feeling, the belief that it's in God's hands.
You know, you're not even breathing.
I think we both feel that it's okay if, you know, if our lives are over at any time, because we've had so much.